Psalm 19:14 is a prayer, and certainly my prayer this morning. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Father, this is the prayer of your people this morning, that as we gather around your word, all that is spoken, all that is sung, all that is considered might be acceptable to you. For you are our rock, you are our redeemer, and we give you glory this day. Father, minister to us. You know our needs, and you know, Father, that we are needy, and we pray that you would provide for your people, and that you would give light, Father, to those still in darkness through your word today. We ask this in Jesus' name, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing, O God, our help in ages past, hymn 48.
This morning's reading will be 1 Chronicles chapter 9. We'll be reading verses 28 through 34. That's 1 Chronicles chapter 9, verses 28 through 34, the reading of God's holy and inerrant inspired word. Now some of them were in charge of the serving vessels, for they brought them in and took them out by count. Some of them were appointed over the furnishings and over all the implements of the sanctuary and over the fine flour and the wine and the oil and the incense and the spices. And some of the sons of the priests made the ointment of the spices. Mattithiah of the Levites, the firstborn of Shallum the Korahite, had the trusted office over the things that were baked in the pans. And some of their brethren of the sons of the Kohathites were in charge of preparing the showbread for every Sabbath. These are the singers, heads of the fathers' houses of the Levites, who lodged in the chambers and were free from other duties, for they were employed in that work day and night. These heads of the fathers' houses of the Levites were heads throughout their generations. They dwelt at Jerusalem. You may be seated. All right, we're continuing our reading now of the role of the Levites. We've been looking at, as some of the Israelites have been trickling back from their captivity, God is reestablishing his worship in the temple. And by these genealogies, there was the practical application of those that were born of the Levites had specific roles according to their families. Last week, we looked at the gatekeepers, and we saw that their role was to open the doors and close the doors of the temple. They were also charged with making sure that all the worshipers that came in were allowed to come in and were clean before the law, and that they would worship properly and not incur any wrath upon themselves for worshiping incorrectly. We also looked at that gate of the temple, as a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom we enter in, the true gate, the true entrance to the temple of God. This week, we look at a few more roles that the Levites had in the work of the temple and what their roles were. We see that some of them worked on ministering vessels. Others would prepare fine flour, wine, and oil for the worship of God. Others worked on holy anointing oil. And we see that there is within God's temple very defined roles that he gives for his worship. So he is a God of order. And God is very specific in how we worship him. And we see his character revealed in how these servants were brought up after genealogy in his temple. Something I notice here too as well in verse 33, we see how God had singers day and night in the temple. And what's interesting in that verse, we see that they were free from other duties, for they were employed of the work of singing day and night. And I guess I've always known, you know, we know that God, you know, when we worship through song, it's something that is pleasing to God. But here we see how God heard in the music of the temple was day and night. And it gives us a sense of how pleasing song is to our God. And, you know, we just finished singing a hymn, right? Do we ever really stop and think that, you know, we sing them, sometimes it becomes a little routine. But we have to sometimes take a step back and realize God's very pleased when he hears songs from his people. And he's very pleased. You know, we've been blessed, and, you know, we have Joanne plays a piano, Tammy, we have Marianne, we, you know, Kevin when he's home, we have, you know, servants that allow us to worship through song. And, you know, it gives us renewed appreciation, I think, to think about how important that is in our worship. And, you know, from there, too, now we can also think of how when we sing, it's also a reminder to us of the new heaven and the new earth, right? These songs went on in the temple day and night. And when we're with God in heaven, we will be singing and praising him day and night. There will be no sleeping, no rest, but the songs of worship and praise will be to God continually. Now, as far as an application here this morning, you know, we move forward to the New Testament church, and we also have roles in the New Testament church to worship God. And this isn't by family genealogy. We are called to God's church. We are children of Abraham by faith. And we're all given the gift of the Holy Spirit, right? Ephesians 4 says, we've all been gifted. If you are a Christian there, sitting here today, this morning, you have the Holy Spirit inside of you, and that Holy Spirit has given you a gift. So the exhortation is, are we praying about and are we using the gift that God has given us to serve him in his temple, right? I mean, we're not safe to come here every Sunday and hear a great sermon and then go home. You know, we're safe to serve God, right? We're saved to serve and build his temple. And everybody who's a Christian this morning has that gift. So, you know, I'll let the Holy Spirit do his work in your life. But be mindful of the fact that God is pleased with the service of his people. And each one of us, like these Levites, have a role to play in God's kingdom. And may we fulfill it to his glory. Amen.
Our Father and our God, our brother has given us a great reminder that we are not simply individuals standing before you. We are part of one another. We are members of your body. We are a part of your church. And as such, Father, it is appropriate that we follow the example of those within the scriptures, such as Nehemiah, who come before you, as he says, confessing the sins of the sons of Israel, which we have sinned against you. He certainly understood that corporate context in which your people exist. And so, Father, it is good and right that we come before you acknowledging as a people, as your church, that we are not what we ought to be. Father, we do not love one another as we ought to. We do not exercise the gifts which you have given as we ought to. We do not understand, Father, our place within the body of Christ as we ought to. We do not realize the the damage that is done to the body when we are not fulfilling that role which you have given to us. Father, we confess all of these things to you, knowing not only that your grace covers them through Christ, but also, Father, that by your Spirit you are still working in us to overcome these things and to make us who and what we ought to be. We pray that you would do so, Father. We thank you that you are a gracious God who forgives, who pardons. But Father, you are a God who is also about the work of sanctifying your people and making us what we ought to be. Father, give us a love for the church, for one another. Father, cause us to have servants' hearts, which will be willing, Father, to put ourselves out and to sacrifice for one another. Cause us to understand, Father, that in this is love. Not that we loved you, but that you loved us and sent your Son to be the propitiation for our sins, and that if you so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Make that a reality here in this place, among this people, and we will give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's open our Bibles again to the book of the Psalms. We come to Psalm 32 this morning as we continue reading through this wonderful book of worship, the hymnal of Old Covenant Israel. Psalm 32 this morning, a psalm of David. How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as with the fever heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly pray to you in a time when you may be found. Surely, in a flood of great waters, they will not reach him. For you are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way which you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose trappings include bit and bridle to hold them in check. Otherwise, they will not come near to you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but he who trusts in the Lord, loving kindness shall surround him. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous ones. And shout for joy, all you who are upright in heart. I can't just pass this by this morning. There may be one here this morning who is under the conviction of their own sin, who has looked at their life and they have seen darkness and wickedness and evil and disobedience. The words of King David come to you this morning. If that is you, if you have kept silent about your sin and you're sensing today that the heavy hand of God is upon you, convicting you of that sin, you need to hear this psalm. How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. It is possible to get out from under your sin, to get out from under the guilt and the burden which is weighing you down. Forgiveness is here in Christ. It is possible to be blessed. It is possible to have your sin covered, forgiven through faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. Confess your sin and trust in Christ, and He will redeem. Let's pray together. Father, what a glorious psalm this is. I pray, Father, that before this day is out, everyone in this room will be able to say, I am the blessed man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity. We are so grateful, Father, for the great gift you have given of your Son, who went to the cross and took upon himself sin, so that all those who would come and trust in him and repent of their sin might be redeemed, forgiven, covered. Thank you, Father, that you do not impute to the blessed man iniquity, but rather you impute to him your own righteousness. It is in that righteousness that we stand. We are grateful, Father. Cause anyone here this morning who is yet outside of Christ to acknowledge their sin to you, not to hide their iniquity, but to confess their transgression, that you may forgive, for you are a forgiving and redeeming God. Thank you, Father, for your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Blessed man, that the Savior will lead us. Let's stand together, hymn 440.
Ushers, please come forward. But who am I, and what is my people, that we should be able to give so willingly after this sort? For all things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. We thank you, Lord, for doing so much, and for your grace through Jesus Christ our Lord. And in his name we pray. Amen.
Take our Bibles again, please, and turn to the prophet Isaiah, chapter 51. Isaiah chapter 51, we're going to pick up with verse 9 this morning and continue through chapter 52, verse 12. Awake. Awake, put on strength, O arm of the Lord. Awake as in the days of old, the generations of long ago. Was it not you who cut Rahab in pieces, who pierced the dragon? Was it not you who dried up the sea, the waters of the great deep, who made the depths of the sea a pathway for the redeemed to cross over? So the ransomed of the Lord will return and come with joyful shouting to Zion, and everlasting joy will be on their heads. They will obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. I am he who comforts you. Who are you that you are afraid of man who dies and of the son of man who is made like grass? That you have forgotten the Lord your Maker, who stretched out the heavens and laid the foundations of the earth, that you fear continually all day long because of the fury of the oppressor as he makes ready to destroy. But where is the fury of the oppressor? The exile will soon be set free and will not die in the dungeon, nor will his bread be lacking. For I am the Lord your God, who stirs up the sea and its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. I have put my words in your mouth and have covered you with the shadow of my hand to establish the heavens, to found the earth, and to say to Zion, you are my people. Rouse yourself, rouse yourself. Arise, O Jerusalem, you who have drunk from the Lord's hand the cup of his anger. The chalice of reeling you have drained to the dregs. There is none to guide her among all the sons she has borne, nor is there one to take her by the hand among all the sons she has reared. These two things have befallen you. Who will mourn for you? The devastation and destruction, famine and sword, how shall I comfort you? Your sons have fainted. They lie helpless at the head of every street, like an antelope in a net, full of the wrath of the Lord, the rebuke of your God. Therefore, please hear this, you afflicted, who are drunk but not with wine. Thus says your Lord, the Lord, even your God, who contends for his people. Behold, I have taken out of your hand the cup of reeling, the chalice of my anger. You will never drink it again. I will put it into the hand of your tormentors, who have said to you, lie down that we may walk over you. You have even made your back like the ground and like the street for those who walk over it. Awake, awake, clothe yourself in your strength, O Zion. Clothe yourself in your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For the uncircumcised and the unclean will no longer come into you. Shake yourself from the dust. Rise up, O captive Jerusalem. Loose yourself from the chains around your neck, O captive daughter of Zion. For thus says the Lord, you were sold for nothing, and you will be redeemed without money. For thus says the Lord God, my people went down at the first into Egypt to reside there. Then the Assyrian oppressed them without cause. Now therefore, what do I have here, declares the Lord, seeing that my people have been taken away without cause? Again, the Lord declares, those who rule over them howl, and my name is continually blasphemed all day long. Therefore, my people shall know my name. Therefore, in that day, I am the one who is speaking. Here I am. How lovely on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who announces peace and brings good news of happiness, who announces salvation and says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. They shout joyfully together, for they will see with their own eyes when the Lord restores Zion. Break forth, shout joyfully together, you waste places of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, that all the ends of the earth may see the salvation of our God. Depart, depart, go out from there, touching nothing unclean. Go out of the midst of her, purify yourselves, you who carry the vessels of the Lord. But you will not go out in haste, nor will you go as fugitives, for the Lord will go before you, and the God of Israel will be your rear guard. Father, once again, we ask that the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, would be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In 1731, J.S. Bach wrote a cantata known in English as Sleepers Awake. I won't try to pronounce the German. As you may know, Bach wrote much of his music specifically for the church to be used in worship. And when Sleepers Awake was first performed, the gospel that was read during that particular service was Matthew chapter 25 and the parable of the wise and foolish virgins. You'll remember the parable. Five of the virgins were ready for the bridegroom's arrival. Five were not. And as a result, they were excluded from the marriage feast. They had fallen asleep. The cantata, which makes allusion to that parable, says this in part, "Awake! Calls the voice of the watchman to us, very high up on the battlements. Awake, you city of Jerusalem. This is the hour of midnight, calling us with a clear voice. Where are your wise virgins? Prepare, the bridegroom is coming. Arise and take your lamps. Alleluia. Make yourselves ready for the wedding. You must go forth to meet him. Zion hears the watchman singing. Her heart leaps with joy. She wakes and rises in haste. Her friend comes from heaven in splendor, strong in mercy, mighty in truth. Her light burns bright. Her star rises. Now come, you worthy crown, Lord Jesus, God's Son. Hosanna. We all follow to the hall of joy and join the Lord's Supper." It's often, isn't it, that we often reverse things. We find ourselves telling God that he needs to wake up. We witness events like those of this past week, and those who don't understand, those who don't care about the truth of God as he has revealed it in his word, assume that he is somehow not on the job. Perhaps he's otherwise occupied. Perhaps he is sleeping. We hear from rebellious ones who desire to do nothing more than ridicule and mock that God does not know. God is asleep. But there are even those of us who love God and trust him most of the time who have difficulty understanding. And deep down, even those who are his, sometimes we hear this faint voice that wonders whether or not God needs to wake up. Of course, the reality is that we are the ones who need to wake up. The reality is that it is men and women and boys and girls who need to come alive to the gospel. And as we read this portion of Isaiah this morning, I hope you picked up on his tone. It is one of passion. It is one of urgency. It is the urgency of one who understands the holiness and the righteousness of God. It is the urgency of one who understands that God will not be patient forever. It is the urgency of one who understands his times and what is coming and knows that there is but one escape. In that urgency, Isaiah is urging us to wake up. Just as Paul wrote, "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Certainly, there is an urgency for those who are outside of Christ to hear the gospel, to repent of their sin, and to trust in the one who died for sinners. But there is an urgency for us who are God's people as well. Isaiah is speaking to God's people here, to God's covenant people. He's saying, let us have no more of this dreamy, complacent, nominal Christianity. Wake up and pursue the life of discipleship to which you have been called. Let's look how he does this. We'll see throughout this passage, this repetition, awake, awake. And when we see that, it's addressed to different people. In verses 9 through 16, we find this first section and this first instance of this phrase, awake, awake, is actually addressed to God. Awake, awake, put on strength, O arm of the Lord. Awake is in the days of old, the generation of long ago. The first person told to awaken is God himself, but this isn't some kind of arrogant ridicule. It's a plea for God to take action, just as we know he is able to do, and we know because he's already done it, and that's what Isaiah goes on to proclaim. As in the days of old, the generations long ago. And then he rehearses some of the things that God has done that should give us confidence that God, just as he acted on behalf of his people in the past, can do it again, and indeed will do it again. But as we've said, sometimes it feels to us as though perhaps God has dozed off. After all, we do. We all too often want to make God into our own image. Of course, God never dozes off. He never falls asleep. He never fails. He has, however, built waiting into our experience. God works his will in such a way that sometimes he requires us to wait for him to act because he's got purposes in that as well. So this bold prayer doesn't offend God. Jesus himself taught us to pray with a certain amount of impudence, right? Come and knock on the door and don't stop knocking until somebody comes and answers, right? We can pray that way. There is a way to beseech God with both urgency and humility, and that's what's going on here. This is a prayer that clings to God in the worst of life, with confidence that he can make obstacles into a way. He can transform things so that we see those things in our lives which seem to be blocking us from getting where we want to go, and God can transform them into a path. Isaiah, I think, in most of what we find here in these opening verses, is thinking of the Exodus. God bringing his people out from bondage, the original breakthrough salvation event, which the prophets so often refer back to. Was it not you who dried up the sea, verse 10, the waters of the great deep, who made the depths of the sea a pathway for the redeemed to cross over? That's what God does. We're standing at the edge of the sea and we see nothing but an obstacle. There's no way of getting through this. And God makes a way. He transforms that which we perceive as an obstacle into the path. He's done it before. He can do it again. And the way he describes it illuminates this historical fact with spiritual insight. Right? He comes and he speaks about all of this that God has done. Why? What is God going to do as a result of what he has done? Right? He made the depths of the sea a pathway for the redeemed to cross over, so the ransomed of the Lord will return. Those of you who are now in exile, who don't see any way out, God will make a way. Right? That word there at the beginning of verse 11, so, that's the connecting phrase, you see. God's done this in the past. He has redeemed his people. He saved his people. He's rescued his people. He's delivered his people. He's brought them out of Egypt, even over the Red Sea. So, he's going to do the same thing in your situation. He's done it before. He'll do it again. This is what God does. And it's put in the form of a question, right? Verse 10, was it not you? And the obvious answer is, of course it was. Who else could it have been? Of course I did it. Our world is still asleep. Our world disregards the power of God. Our world pays lip service to powerless religion of platitudes and cliches while it denies the power of the gospel and the reality of God's power to save, the reality of God's involvement in history, the reality that there is indeed a battle raging all around us. The world is asleep. But those who know Christ know the truth. Those who have ears to hear understand the reality of the situation. Those who have eyes to see understand that God is at work even in suffering and tragedy and disaster and calamity. Even when we can't figure out where he's going to make the way, where he's going to bring deliverance. Yet we understand that joy comes in the morning. We understand that there will be a day when sorrow and sighing will flee away. That's what we're told here in verse 11. So the ransomed of the Lord will return and come with joyful shouting to Zion. And everlasting joy will be on their heads. They will obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. You exiles, do you understand what God's going to do? You who are in bondage, you who are taken away from your homes and scattered throughout the world, sighing and sorrow are going to flee away. The day is not done. God has more. Isaiah evokes the historical exodus from Egypt from his vantage point already long ago in order to portray a future hope. It is based on who God is, as evidenced by what God has done. He's saying that the final homecoming of those ransomed by the cross will be an unforeseeable, Exodus-like breakout, but even better. This time, our joy will be everlasting. It will be unmixed. As Isaiah says in 35, verse 10, another translation is, gladness and joy will overtake them. That's a great phrase. It will overtake them. They're not going to find it themselves. They're going to be in a situation in which they are oppressed. They are the victims, if you will, of the opposition of the world and the enemy upon them. And in that situation, gladness and joy will overtake them. God's going to catch up with the situation. How could it be otherwise? For God to hold out the prospect of joy, but a joy forever mingled with sorrow and sighing would be too much like the present to give us any hope. But there's going to be a difference between the imperfect, incomplete joy which we sometimes experience now and that eternal joy which is awaiting us. That eternal joy will be pure. That eternal joy will not be mixed with the kind of sorrow that we experience today in this present world. God wants us to know that he will allow no place in his coming kingdom for even a trace of the present sorrows that we experience. They will flee before the onrush of this formidable joy, which is worthy of all our hopes now here in the present. This is why it's a glorious hope. We are, as the people of God, to be a forward-looking people. Yes, we live here in the present. We exist here in the present. We understand that. We're not trying to unduly look for an escape out of the present. But we do live in the light of a future that is going to be far different than that which we are experiencing here. And that is one of the reasons why we can live in the midst of trial, yet with joy. It's not the joy we're going to experience. It's a mixed joy. But there's joy nonetheless, because we're seeing the tragedy, we're seeing calamity, we're seeing evil, we're seeing suffering in the light of what is yet to come. If we don't understand that there is yet a future, then we have nothing. We have nothing but what is. And what is, if you've been paying attention, ain't so great. But God tells us, no, there is a day when sorrow and sighing will flee away. And this is a day for my people. Right here, we see the kind of God that we love and serve. He is a God who hears the heart-wrenching pleas of his people, and he answers. Look at verses 12 and 13. I am he who comforts you. Even though you're not there yet in the future where sorrow and sighing will flee away, I am comforting you, even in the midst of what you're dealing with now. Who are you that you are afraid of man who dies and of the son of man who is made like grass, that you have forgotten the Lord your maker who stretched out the heavens and laid the foundations of the earth, that you fear continually all day long because of the fury of the oppressor as he makes ready to destroy? But where is the fury of the depressor, of the oppressor? Right. God meets that plea in verse 9, awake, awake, with verse 12, I. He is not asleep. He hears the cries of his people, and he is all the answer that we need. I am he who comforts you. He is the one who is able to breathe life into despairing people. He admonishes us for being overly impressed with the men who do evil. But God asks instead, where is the fury of the oppressor? No human evil is going to stand when God has given you his promises. Timidity is the default setting of our minds, but the fear of man is a denial of God. His promises ought to make us bold. Be courageous. That's the exhortation of the people when they were going into the land. Right? Be courageous. God is your God. And men cannot stand before him. Isn't this the temptation that we face this week? Once again, the evil of Islam has been brought near to us. And the temptation is to fear the fury of the oppressor as he makes ready to destroy. The temptation is to lock ourselves away, like everyone in Boston did this past week. The temptation is to despair for the future. But Isaiah reminds us that though the enemy can make bombs, it is our God who stretches out the heavens. Though the enemy can cause destruction, it is our God who has laid the foundations of the earth. Though the enemy can inspire terror, it is our God who brings eternal joy. Armando Valladares was a prisoner of Castro for 22 years. And in prison, he says his faith in Christ came alive. He describes it this way. I had come to prison with religious feeling. My beliefs were genuine, but no doubt superficial at that time, since they had never been submitted to hard trial. I held to the religion I had learned at home and at school, but it was very much like a man who has acquired good manners, or who carries along the lessons of the things he first learned to read without examining them. But very quickly, I began to experience a substantial change in the nature of my beliefs. There came a moment when, seeing those young men full of courage depart to die before the firing squad, shouting, "Viva Cristo Rey," long live Christ the King, at the fateful instant, I not only understood instantly, as though by a sudden revelation, that Christ was indeed there for me at the moments when I prayed not to be killed, but realized as well that he served to give my life and my death, if it came to that, meaning. Both my life and my death would be dignified by my belief in him. Because of my situation, it seemed my life would necessarily be a life of resistance, but I would be sustained in it by a soul filled with love and hope. Those cries of the executed patriots, "Long live Christ the King, down with communism," had wakened me to a new life as they echoed through the 200-year-old moats of the fortress. The cries became such a potent and stirring symbol that by 1963, the men condemned to death were gagged before being carried down to be shot. The jailers feared those shouts. The gospel inspires courage to stand in the face of the enemy, because we understand that the enemy is not the enemy of human beings. It's not the enemy of a political entity. Ultimately, the enemy that we're facing is the enemy of God himself. And God will defend those who align themselves with him. The Lord is on my side, the psalmist says. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Christ can even turn fear around. True courage comes not from our own bravado, but from the promises of God. Resting in him, trusting in him, understanding that he is faithful to what he has promised. If we are to fend for ourselves, however strong we may be, we are doomed. But if God is watching over us, if we belong to him, if his promises are ours, then we can face anything, even with quiet joy. And you can go back through church history and read the accounts of martyr after martyr after martyr who did just that. Not because they had courage within themselves, but because they trusted in the God who had promised them joy. I am the God who comforts you. That's what God wants us to grasp. And God forms an unbreakable bond with his people, and he gives them firm promises. And those promises come out here. Look at verse 14. The exile will soon be set free and will not die in the dungeon, nor will his bread be lacking. For I am the Lord your God, who stirs up the sea and its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. I have put my words in your mouth and have covered you with the shadow of my hand to establish the heavens, to found the earth, and to say to Zion, you are my people. And so if we were to imagine a conversation between God and us, it might go something like this. God says, I am your God. You are my people. I will bless you. But at our best, Lord, we barely believe you. God says, true, but I will bless you. But Lord, we don't deserve you. Lord, to say, yeah, more than you know. But I will bless you. But Lord, we don't live up to this. We are cowards. Yeah, you are, but I will bless you. It's about we're so entrenched in this world. Lord, it doesn't seem like we're ever going to change. And I think the Lord would say, now that is not true. Because I will change you. You are Zion. You are my eternal city. And I will bless you accordingly. And everything will change. That's what God does for his people. God promises, and God fulfills, and God blesses, and God changes, and we don't deserve any of it. And God says, that doesn't matter. That's not the point. The point is not you. The point is me. The point is the greatness of my grace. The point is the greatness of my power. The point is the greatness of my mercy. You are the objects of all of that, so that I might be glorified. That's why God say, well, Lord, I'm not this, I'm not that, I'm not the other thing, and I can't. And that misses the point entirely. The point is, God can do what he will in spite of us, in spite of our weakness, in spite of our inability. What makes God so great is that he can still save people like us. And he can redeem people like us. And he can sanctify people like us. He can make us like his son, Jesus Christ. That's what makes him so great. And that's what's going to happen on the day when Jesus returns. And according to Ephesians 2:7, God points to us and says, look at these people. Look at how great my kindness and my mercy are. I could save even them. Isn't it what Paul wrote to the Corinthians? Right? God saved the weak. Right? God saved the lowly. God saved the base. And he says to them, just look at yourselves. You're the example. You guys aren't anything. And yet God chose you. Why? To glorify himself. It's because of this truth that Isaiah now turns and addresses these rebellious people. Verse 17, rouse yourself, arise, O Jerusalem. You who have drunk from the Lord's hand the cup of his anger, the chalice of reeling you have drained to the dregs. Isaiah sees the people of God lying in this drunken stupor, having been force-fed a bitter cup of God's wrath in their captivity. And they have reeled and they have collapsed in despair. No human defense or comfort could help. There is none to guide her among all the sons she has borne. Nor is there one to take her by the hand among all the sons she has reared. Who will mourn? Devastation and destruction, famine and sword. How shall I comfort you? Your sons have fainted. They lie helpless. Full of the wrath of the Lord, the rebuke of your God. There is no one to help. Humanly speaking, there is no hope. And now Isaiah reveals the good news inside of that bad news. The God who put that cup to their lips can take it away. The God who brought wrath can remove his wrath and redeem those who were once under his wrath. Therefore, please hear this, you afflicted who are drunk but not with wine. Thus says the Lord even your God, who contends for his people. Behold, I have taken out of your hand the cup of reeling. The chalice of my anger, you will never drink it again. I will put it in the hand of your tormentors. I'm going to change everything. The wrath that came upon you, I will now put upon them. I contend for you. You may not see it right now, but this is the reality. You are my people. And you have never stopped being my covenant people. And I will contend for you. A new day of grace has dawned. For the Jews in Babylon, this meant getting up and returning to the promised land. For us today, it means getting up and entering into the promises of Christ. And when that happens, everything changes. We go from being under God's wrath to being protected by his grace. Isaiah's saying to us all, it isn't God who needs to be aroused. You do. Wake up. See, understand all that God has done. His salvation is ready and waiting. Come. This is what he says coming into chapter 52. Awake, awake. Clothe yourself in your strength, O Zion. See? The first awake was toward God. Now he's speaking to the people, to Zion. Clothe yourself in beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. God wants Lady Zion to stop feeling sorry for herself. Throw off her chains, put on these beautiful garments that he has laid out for her. Why? Because the uncircumcised and the unclean will no longer come into you. Shake yourself from the dust, rise up, O captive Jerusalem, loose yourselves from the chains around your neck, O captive daughter of Zion. There was a time when the faithful city had fallen to the level of a prostitute, but now, because of what God has done, she is a queen once more. And she is to clothe herself by the power of God's grace in just that way. Now, the exiles didn't see themselves in any remarkable way. They felt neither the magnitude of their guilt nor the majesty of God's grace. It's true that they were the captive daughter of Zion. Their sufferings were real, but when they lost their sense of God, all that was left to them was their victimhood. This is why we all need to hear the gospel again and again and again. Martin Luther wisely said, it cannot be beaten into our ears enough or too much. Yes, though we learn it and understand it well, yet there is none that takes hold of it perfectly or believes it with all his heart. So frail a thing is our flesh and disobedient to the Spirit. The truth is, we scarcely believe that through Christ everything is made new. There is a new freshness. There is a new freedom that has come, as Isaiah says. And he's urging us to enter into the experience of this new position. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore. Do not submit again to a yoke of slavery, we're told. This new identity is ours. We receive it from Christ. Isaiah says, there shall be no more come into you. The uncircumcised and the unclean. What does that mean? Does that mean Gentiles don't have a place? No. When you understand the New Testament, when you understand what God has done, we understand that he does not keep uncircumcised physically outside. He invites them in. What he does is circumcise their hearts through regeneration. It's true that in Zion, there is no place for the uncircumcised and unclean. But what God does is to make those who were uncircumcised and unclean fit for his kingdom. Circumcised of heart, purified by the blood of Christ, forgiven, redeemed. God calls anyone clean who has been washed in Christ. Isaiah's point is that the glory of Zion will never be taken away again, because it isn't worldly prestige or even religious prestige. What sets the people of God apart is the beauty of holiness. Put on these beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. And anyone who is willing to leave their dirty garments out and put on new beautiful garments will be welcomed in. That's what Christ does. He cleanses us. He purifies us. He makes us clean. This is the gospel. For thus says the Lord, you were sold for nothing, and you will be redeemed without money. This is the glory of the gospel, isn't it? It's completely free. You don't have to pay for anything. All you need do is come. Leave your sin and come and give yourself to Christ.
You don't have to pay a thing. It's free. God has done it all. There are those who talk about the gospel and confuse that issue. They'll say things like, well, God's done all he could do, but now it's up to you to take that last step. It's up to you to do this, to do that, to do the other thing. That's not the gospel. God does it all. God draws you. God gives you the gift of repentance. God gives you the gift of faith. God convicts you, and if you are being convicted of your sin, as I call you to repent and to trust in Christ, I do so knowing you can't do that unless God is at work in you. Yes, you need to respond. The Philippian jailer said, what must I do to be saved? Paul told him, believe. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that's all. Don't go and go through this ritual and don't go through those ceremonies. And you don't have to get yourself righteous enough. Just believe. And that includes repentance. You're leaving the old life and you're coming into something new. And you're allowing God to cleanse you and purify you and make you new. It's without cost. Christ paid the price. That's the cost. The Son of God and his blood, that's the cost. It's the cost that God gave. The community of redemption is open to all alike because God refuses every penny of our self-righteous moral currency. He doesn't want any of that. He can't use it. He doesn't need it. And we don't have any anyway. Everything we think we have is counterfeit. It's not worth anything. We have nothing to offer him. And so he says, just come and receive. Come and receive. And God intends to display this glorious grace of his to all who are willing to come. Look at verse 6. Therefore, my people shall know my name. Therefore, in that day, I am the one who is speaking. Here I am. Here I am. God is displaying his glory through his people. He's sending out messengers into the world so that through his word, people might be awakened to faith in Christ, which alone brings redemption. And he says, this is a beautiful thing. It is just marvelous. It is beautiful. This is how I work. How lovely on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who announces peace, who brings good news of happiness, who announces salvation. Now we need to understand here, that which I hope is obvious, Isaiah is not admiring someone's feet. Right? Feet can be pretty hideous things after all. He is saying what a welcome sound it is to hear the footfall of one who brings good news. Right? You think of the Greek warrior running from Marathon to Athens, right? I think 490 BC, somewhere around there, with the message, rejoice, we have conquered. And he had to get word back to his people so they wouldn't surrender to the Persians, who have already been defeated. We might think of someone today pacing back and forth, waiting in suspense for an important phone call. When it finally rings, you know, we jump with excitement. What is God's news to us sinners? It is peace. It is happiness. It is salvation. Your God reigns. That's how Isaiah summed it up. The message is not that we can make God victorious, but that his grace has already won the victory over everything that comes against us. So we must not surrender. The message is not that God loves us, but that he loves us with a love that cannot be defeated, even by our own stupidity. This is the gospel, the finished work of Christ on the cross, his resurrection and ascension, his authority over everything. There is power within this good news to lift us up out of our defeatism. There is no end to the impact of the gospel. It affects every part of who we are. It affects our entire existence. It is the only cause in the world that will fully and finally succeed. Everything else is going to fail. God will be victorious, and he will be victorious through the gospel. Isaiah envisions this lone messenger running to the city of God with good news, welcomed by the watchmen on the city wall. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. They shout joyfully together, for they will see with their own eyes when the Lord restores Zion. And the city breaks forth, shouting joyfully together, your waste places of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the city of all, in the sight of all the nations, that all the ends of the earth may see the salvation of our God. That's what God is doing. That's what he's doing now. As the gospel goes forth and God brings in men and women from every tribe and tongue and nation, he is making his glory known to the ends of the earth. But once again, we need to ask, how will you respond to this message? Well, you've got to make a change, don't you? You need to understand that in responding to this great message of grace, you are changing sides. You are, as Isaiah puts it, departing from the enslavement in which you have lived and moving into the freedom of the gospel. Depart, depart out from there. Touch nothing unclean. Go out of the midst of her. Purify yourselves, you who carry the vessels of the Lord. But you will not go out in haste, nor will you go out as fugitives, for the Lord will go before you, and the God of Israel will be your rear guard. As you leave, as you depart, don't go running off like cowards. You leave with a boldness and a confidence and a security, because it doesn't matter if, like Egypt, they decide to come after you. The Lord is your rear guard, and he will protect you, and he will defend you. Which city will be our home? Where will our identity be found, in Babylon or Zion? The people of God cannot remain where they are. Israel had to leave. They had to leave Egypt. They had to leave Babylon. And we too must decide. God is telling us to run from every system of false salvation and to get out. And we do that by turning to Christ. We do that by resting in the gospel. And he expects us to make a clean break, because he has something better for us. God is not calling for our social withdrawal and isolation, but for a spiritual distinction to be made. Through Christ, he gives his people the new dignity of priesthood. You who bear the vessels of the Lord. To put it in New Testament terms, we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. So we must be clear in our message. We must be clear in our influence. We are bearing a holy thing out to the nations when we take the gospel. It is nothing to be trifled with. Certainly it is nothing to be changed. The gospel of God is his power unto salvation. We do not have the authority to make it and mold it into something different because we think this will make it more attractive to the world. We do that, it loses all its power, becomes something different completely. We are bearing a holy thing to the world. Anything about us that might make the victory of God ambiguous or unattractive must go. We are ambassadors speaking the word of God, not representing ourselves, but representing him. So we come in his authority and we do this in his way, with his power. We purify ourselves then from every unclean thing. And Isaiah gives us two reasons to remake our lives into this kind of holy pilgrimage, spreading the good news as far as we can. First, our motivation is not panic, but confidence. We don't run out of the world. We depart and we touch nothing unclean, but we don't go out in haste or as fugitives. We are and will be victorious. God has ensured this. And so this is how we conduct ourselves in the world, not being timid and not running away and not being embarrassed, but with confidence, not in ourselves, but in the work of God and his gospel. Secondly, we have God himself as our strong escort and as our rear guard. God is on the move with us. He goes before his people and he follows after his people. And we have no reason to stay there. We have good reasons to press on. And while we've been lying asleep in self-absorption and despair, Christ has been busy. He has won the most meaningful victory imaginable on our behalf. He has made us more than conquerors. He is sending us to the nations with a message of pure and endless human joy that is open to all those who will leave the world and come to him. That's the message that we bring. And he is watching over us as we go. He is coming again in final and eternal victory. But until that point comes, until that day arrives, we need to wake up and get ready and get on with the work. God will accomplish it. That there is no doubt about. He will accomplish his work. But it is our part to be a part of that work, to be the instruments that he uses to accomplish that work. He does that through his people. It is a glorious privilege, isn't it? All that God has been about from the beginning of redemptive history, we have a part in. We have a role to play. He can use us as he builds his kingdom. Let's be a part of that great building project until Jesus comes. Father, thank you for your grace, for your word, for your son. Thank you for the gospel. We would ask, Father, that you would give us a burden for the world, that we would not see the world merely as an enemy to be avoided or something to escape, but as that mission field to go out into to proclaim the great victory that is already yours. That those whom you have chosen from before the foundation of the world would hear your voice and would follow. These things, Father, we ask because we are concerned with your glory and we desire to be a part of your great victory. Bring it to pass, Father. May Jesus come quickly. It is in his name that we ask these things. Amen. Thank you.
Forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.